Hey everybody, let's see, I'm going to see if that gets going. Ta-da. Cool, do you see my slide?
Yes.
Awesome. Cool, so today we're going to be looking at how the Italian fencing masters approach different type of opponents. But I really wish I had Rage Against the Machine playing in the background right now, because I feel like it's a perfect song for this particular presentation. Before we get into it, just a little bit about me so people have an idea of what my expertise level is. Been fencing since 2006, started off as a foil fencer. I joined the SCA in 2010. Started doing Italian Rapier in 2012 when Academy Duello launched their Duello.tv, that just online learning environment. Helped me a lot in learning the basics of Italian, because reading straight from the books without any kind of base knowledge can be extremely difficult. So I've been doing Italian Rapier for the past 8 years, but in terms of doing it as a martial ANS, it's only been the past like 3 or so years. Before that, I was really like, I'm reading these books and doing Italian Rapier so I can be a better fighter. And now I'm also getting a little bit more interested in like a lot of the theory behind it, which is going to help me as a fencer in tournaments, but it also just kind of like the ANS side of things as well, like the research and trying to make connections and stuff like that. I primarily read out of Alfieri, but I also have experience with Capifraro, Giganti, and Fabris. They're all very similar in their styles and stuff. So you can easily kind of like take ideas from one into the other for the most part. In terms of my actual fighting, I'm former East Kingdom King's Rapier champion, been the general for the East Kingdom Rapier Army, and I've been on the Pensive Champs team 6 times. Outside of the SCA, I am a Rapier instructor for the Athena School of Arms. I started teaching with them last fall, and I'm supposed to be in the middle of another Rapier class with them, but we're all stuck indoors, so we'll see when I can kick things back up with them. I'm also a level 1 student guide and apprentice instructor through Academy Duello. They have their own like tiers basically of expertise level in terms of being a student and instructor and stuff. You can kind of move up to mastery. And I'm also teaching 2 online Italian Rapier classes, 1 for beginners and 1 for intermediate students. So at the beginning of the 17th century, we start seeing Italian fencing masters not just talk about how to defeat your opponents with like mechanics, but also how to approach different opponents. We see that first with Fabris, and then we see also Fabris basically had 1 chapter talking about how to defeat taller or shorter opponents, weaker and stronger opponents, and these different 4 temperaments. Alfieri basically took this 1 chapter and broke it out into 3 separate chapters, and then later on in 1686, Marcelli also did a similar idea with different chapters. I don't have Marcelli, so today's presentation is going to be primarily with Alfieri, with some Fabris thrown in there. Their ideas are basically the same. They just kind of describe things a little bit differently. So when you're kind of like listening to the presentation, assume that all the ideas are coming from one or both of these masters. Once in a great while, I throw in my own ideas, or I kind of extrapolate a little bit or put in a little bit more layman's terms what they're trying to get at, especially for anyone who's been in my classes and stuff. I try to kind of just like use the same terminology that you would hear in the classes just to kind of make things a little bit easier. But in these earlier chapters, they talk about how if you're a shorter fencer, how you can defeat a taller fencer. If you're a taller fencer, how you can defeat a shorter fencer. Same thing with the weak and strong, and also these 4 temperaments that are based on the Hippocratic humors and stuff. So we're going to look at all 3 of these and kind of give people an idea of how they can approach different opponents. And the reason why this is important is because if you approach each different opponent the exact same way, you're gonna have varying levels of success, because how you would approach a shorter fencer is not gonna really work if you're fighting against someone who's taller than you and outranges you. How you would fence someone, or you should fence someone that is very reserved or timid in their fighting style, is much different than someone who is very gung-ho and just gonna try to run you down. And Alfieri, like most Italian fencing masters, is very sassy throughout his fencing video. He had this great quote that I threw in here that kind of really kind of summarizes why it's really good to make sure that you approach different types of fencers. in different ways. So as we go through these presentations, there are two different ways you can kind of take this information. The first is kind of taking this, internalizing for where you fit yourself, so how you fit in these different categories. So kind of think about what your strengths are, which strengths are, how you can leverage these in your fights, what your weaknesses are, how you can turn your weaknesses into strengths or make people think that you're weak in certain spots and turn that into strengths and stuff like that, as well as how to approach your own, like, different opponents and stuff. How can you exploit where they're weak? How can you stay away where they're strong and use different techniques to defeat them and stuff? So if you're typically a taller fencer, you might really think more about how you want to defeat shorter fencers, but you might run into someone who is still taller than you. So it's kind of important to know, like, all aspects of these different types of fighters. So these are the three that we're going to look at: taller and shorter, stronger and weaker, and then the four temperaments. And that's where it gets really kind of interesting. All right, so the tall fencer. The advantages of a tall fencer, and I'm sure that anyone that's been fencing for a while has run into these, and this isn't probably much of a surprise, that they have just more reach in general. Because the taller, they can deliver, and this is a lot of generalities. Obviously, two tall fencers, depending on the athletic ability, one might not really lunge as far as a shorter fencer. First, this is kind of working on overarching general ideas. So tall fencer can deliver a longer lunge that can keep their opponent at bay just by extending their sword, which is kind of nice for them. Because they have longer reach, they have more time. They can throw the first shots on a shorter fencer, and they can just throw more shots because of that. Because that shorter fencer needs to kind of cross, like, no man's land before they can get into a spot where they can throw shots successfully. And because of this, both Fabris and Alfieri in their chapter saying, if you're a tall fencer, all these rules about fencing, about finding and engaging the opponent's blade, you don't really need to observe it too much because you can just reach out and tag your opponent much easier. But they do kind of recommend that you follow, like, making sure you're controlling your opponent's blade and all these other precautions that keep you safe while fencing. If you're taller, you don't have to, but they still think it's a good idea, and I would probably recommend that as well. Disadvantages, but being tall does have its disadvantages. One, there's a larger target here because they're taller. They have more mass to them in general terms, so they're going to be just a little more target space to throw shots at. Alfieri and Fabris both say that taller fencers are slower because of the great weight of their body and limbs. I feel like this is a super, super general idea, because I know plenty of tall fencers that are extremely fast and some shorter fencers that aren't very fast at all. So, like, I disagree a little bit with them on that one, but I put it in here just because they have it in their manual, so I wanted to kind of give people a complete idea of what the master's thoughts were on this. And this last bullet note is me kind of throwing my own ideas out there. In the SCA and HEMA, we see a lot of tall fencers be more successful quicker in tournaments. Like, and by this I mean they get more wins and losses a lot sooner because of their reach. It's just a genetic advantage that allows them to hit shorter fences from a further distance without having to be highly skilled. Doesn't mean that if you're a tall fencer, you aren't skilled at all. It just means you just have this genetic advantage that gives you an edge when fighting shorter fencers. So I think when we have new fencers who are very tall, a lot of them just rely on their reach alone and don't learn a lot of the good fencing mechanics that create highly skilled and highly mastered fencers. But I think, so that kind of helps them a lot in the beginning when they're brand new, but I think their curve, they'll hit a wall at some point where they just can't get over the hump because they're running to higher caliber fencers that have good mastery of the blade and stuff like that. So being tall helps you great in the beginning when you're fighting other people that your same skill level, but I think it can also backfire in the long run if the taller fencer who's new isn't really putting in the time and effort or isn't getting good instruction from the more advanced students and mods and ogres and stuff around them to help them get those skills and stuff. So just kind of my kind of two cents on that one. So how do we defeat the taller opponent? They got this great measure on us, and they can throw shots at us so much earlier, and they can throw more shots before we can get past their point. How can you defeat them? Both Fabris and Alfieri recommend first stay out of measure, basically make them come to you. And you also need to control their sword. You can't just step past their point without making sure that their blade isn't going to be able to hit you. If you just step forward and you don't have control of their blade, they're going to very easily be able to strike you. I can try to go over these in more detail a little bit too as well. And because of this, you only want to move forward when you have control of your opponent's blade. You want to steal measure whenever you can. And by that I mean as your opponent is stepping forward, you also want to step forward while controlling the blade. So while they think they are going to get into, their lunge measure, you actually step closer than that. So you're actually in your lunge measure. So you're closer than they're expecting to. It can really confuse them. Just like they're not expecting you to be that close. And because you're controlling their blade at the same time, you're going to be in a much stronger position to strike them. Alfieri also, I think it's Alfieri, it could be a Fabris, one of the two, also is a strike on the pass. This is basically a passing step or a passing lunge. I think it's perfectly fine to be able to do it with a regular lunge as well. I think that's really kind of like whatever you're more comfortable with. I think it is good to get into Misura Stretta, and this is the narrow measure. So basically, for people taking my class, they would recognize this term. But it's defined by the distance that you can strike your opponent by leaning lunge. So like we're not taking that step lunge that we think of when we think of fencing. We're just shifting our weight from our back leg to our forward leg in stance, and so it looks like we're in a lunge. So we're very close to our opponent. But what's nice about that is that we're well past our opponent's blade. They can't easily hit us with their point. And at that point, that last part of the blade isn't going to be very sharp at all. And it's not going to be very powerful in terms of cuts and stuff. They're just not going to be able to get the same momentum to cut us as they would with the tip of their blade, which is also kind of nice. Other ways you can defeat a taller opponent is use transports to open up the high lines. So taller fencers, because they're taller, they might hold their sword a little bit higher. So being able to using transports to bring their blade down a little bit further to, let's say, our level of where the shorter fencer can kind of open up the high line targets. And the high line targets are anything that's above the hilt of your opponent's sword. So if their hilt is up by the shoulders, if you can bring their blade down, so it's closer to like their pec level, that opens up like several more inches worth of target for you, which is nice. If you find that very difficult, if they hold their sword very high, you can't go over the sword, going underneath the sword is fantastic. We've actually been doing a lot of voids and low-line attacks in my intermediate fencing class the past few weeks. So anytime someone's holding a sword very high, and it really opens up their flank, so basically their armpit down to their hips. So all that like rib cage, belly can be opened up nice with a taller fencer if they're holding this sword high. So things like the spasso, which is an off-step leaning lunge, or the passato sotto, which is a passing underneath the opponent's sword, are two other great ways of being able to hit your opponent. But if they happen to hold their sword down by their hip, which we see a lot in the SCA, you're not going to be able to easily do those low line voids unless you can get them to raise their sword up. If you don't have that line, attacking the line, that's got to be open. One of them have to be open. They can't, and if they're fighting just single rapier, they can't cover both the high line and the low line super, super well. Even with using their offhand, one of those two lines is going to be more open than the other. And also using dewey tempi. So dewey tempi is any action that does takes two times, like a parry or a post. The parry is the first tempo, the post is the second tempo. Can be super useful because a taller opponent is going to be throwing shots sooner at you and quicker and more shots at you. You got to be able to weather those blows so you get past their point. So if you can do a parry or a post, passing, possibly even with one of those passing lunges, you're in a pretty good spot. So really be good at your parries and being able to control your opponent's blade. So all this boils down to is master your art. Master your art. Be a really good fencer. Really try to work on your basics of measure in tempo and being able to control your opponent's blade. So as they're trying, so even if they, so you can get to the point where you control the blade, they never get a chance to throw shots at you until you get into the measure where you can hit them. That's the idea. They can't throw shots at you, you can't get hit, but that really takes a high level of skill, so a lot of practice and stuff, but it is doable. The short fencer, good news for us. The short fencer has advantages. We have a smaller target area. Most of the shots from a taller fencer is going to be covering from above, so our low lying is going to be just less accessible to them by default. Doesn't mean that they can't get there, it just means it's going to be a little more difficult for them. It's easier for us to cover ourselves behind our guard because we're small. We don't need to move our sword as much to defend ourselves, which is nice. It also means because we're not as big, our defensive actions can be smaller. Things like cavicciones, disengages, parries, all these can be smaller actions because we're just not as, we won't have as much body to protect. And we have a bigger safe zone once we pass our opponent's point. So we have this no man's land that we need to, if you're a short defense, you need to cross before you get past it, tip. But once you do, you have, now they're very much at a disadvantage because their tip can't hit you, yours can hit them, and they need to get out of there. And you just have a lot more measure that you can work with at that point. The disadvantage is you need to pass your opponent's point, right? We can't hit our opponent from out of measure. We can't hit them probably from, we can't hit our opponent, taller opponent from their widest measure, so we need to get past that point one way or another somehow. So if you're a tall offender and you're fighting a short offender, how do you defeat them? So the first is to stay on the offensive. You really want the short offender to be defensive, because if they're defensive, it means they can't throw shots at you. They're not easily going to be able to control your blade, which means it's going to be a lot more dangerous for them to try to pass their point. You want to keep them at your measure, and that basically means you always want to make sure that they're in front of your point. Once they get past your point, you're in a heap load of trouble if you're the tall offensive, so you always want to make sure they are on the other side of your point. You want to strike in prima tempo as this opponent steps forward. And prima tempo, for those that don't know, is striking an opponent as they step into your lunge range. So it might be as a stepping forward or stepping backwards. But because the shorter fencer needs to pass the taller fencer's point to be able to get into their own range, they need to step forward at some point. So that gives the taller fencer a good tempo in which they can throw a shot and hit their opponent while they're at a very weak point, or a very vulnerable point, I should say. Retreat as the shorter fencer is trying to gain measure. This can be a little bit difficult in small lists, especially at events like Burger, where the list might be like 8x8 and there's just not a lot of room to move. So at that point, you want to try to give yourself enough room that you can retreat. But if we're in an open field, every time the short offensive tries to get in past your point, just keep retreating and keep retreating. They're going to have to speed up or make a mistake, or force them to make a mistake that you can strike and hit them. You can also use feints to defeat short offensives. Because the short offensive needs to be so defensive as they're coming forward. If you throw a feint and it's very believable, they're going to have to try to parry it if they're not already in their own measure. And this means you can get their sword really moving left and right and create tempos in which you can strike them in the open line and stuff. So if they got a very tight guard and you just can't strike easily, if you can feint to get them to open up a little bit more and then strike where they're not, that's a great tactic as well. And also retreat out of measure after striking your opponent. Once you hit them, don't just stand there and admire the quality work you just did. This is especially true from the martial arts perspective, in which, let's say I'm fighting a taller fencer and the opponent and they hit me, I might not realize I'm dead yet, and I might also hit them. So once you hit your opponent, back out of measure. And that still works even in our sports mentality of rapier fencing, either in the SEA or HEMA. Is when I strike my opponent, I want to get out of measure so we can't get that afterblow. It's not fun having that discussion of was your opponent's shot too late or was it soon enough? That's not a fun conversation for anyone to have. So if we can just make sure they don't hit us at all the more better. But again, you know, put them on the defensive, stay on the offensive. So really this boils down to, if you're the tall offensive, use your reach. This is your, one of your most important and most valuable assets in your fencing repertoire. And this, so try to use it as much as you can. So now we're going to go on to how to defeat stronger and weaker fences. Stronger fences advantages. They can dominate their opponent's sword. They can strike through their opponent's defenses. So even if their opponent has a good parry, if you're much stronger than your opponent, you can just push that parry out of the way and strike them, which is nice. And they're also safer from repose. So let's say I'm stronger than my opponent. I throw a shot and they parry, and they start to repose. It's going to be, if I'm much stronger than them, it's going to be much easier for me to defend myself against that repost. And in fact, if I'm extremely stronger than my opponent, my devil ace, so the weak point of my sword, which is the last quarter or third from the tip of the sword, could be stronger than my opponent's forte. That's an extreme, but it is possible. Disadvantages, according to Fabris and Alfieri, there is no disadvantages to being the stronger fencer because you are naturally superior. This is very coming from a physical genetic kind of standpoint, and not from the standpoint that a strong fencer might be just using their strength only to defeat their opponents, which has its own like tactical weakness. This is really much what's the weakness from being physically stronger than your opponent. And the answer is, according to Fabris and Alfieri. So if you're weaker than your opponent, how can you defeat them if they have no natural disadvantages? Apparently a lot, which is fantastic. First is you cover yourself behind your sword. This means you need to have strong guards. You don't want to just leave yourself open. You always want to make sure that your sword and your guard is between your opponent's blade and your body so they don't have an easy time striking. You also want to use the dexterity of hand, which is to keep your blade free. And this is basically using capriciones, which are disengages. And these, I'll show these what these different disengages actually look like in a second. But the idea is, if your opponent's stronger than you, you're not going to be able to push their blade around. And part of Italian rapier and controlling your opponent's blade is being able to displace their blade while trying to strike them or while they're trying to strike you. But if they're so strong that they're able to easily push you out of the way, it really takes a huge chunk out of what's the typical Italian rapier repertoire and kind of like makes it much more difficult. So you need to kind of think a little bit differently. In this case, you need to really have quick hands and be able to get from line to line. But I'm going to try to explain what these, stop presenting for a second so my camera comes back on. You guys see me again? See me? That's cool. All right, so I'm going to explain what, for people who don't know what these different terminologies are. So I'm just going to bring up my own screen so I can see myself better. All right, cool. So this is us, this is our opponent. So a capriccione is just a disengage. So if our opponent has control over our blade, which means they can easily push it out of the side, a capriccione is just a disengage, which means I'm bringing my point from one line to the other, and so now I have control over their blade. Or at least I am now able to strike on the side that's open. A contra capriccione is a counter to that disengage. So as my opponent goes to find my blade, I do a capriccione, and then that same tempo, they also do a capriccione. So we end up on the same line that my opponent wanted to find me. So just, it's a disengage inside a disengage. Then there's the recapriccione, which is a counter to the counter capriccione. So my opponent goes to find my blade, I capriccione, they contra capriccione, and then I recapriccione to get to the line that I wanted to be on and the line they don't want to be on. So it's just three disengages. And it's very difficult to do, but it's super effective. It's really a great way of confusing your opponent what line you're on. But it does take a lot of practice and really good tempo and good hand speed. And then lastly, there's the mezza capriccione, which is that half disengage. So my opponent has me found up high. I just drop my point low below this sword. My opponent can't push my sword around if they're stronger than me, if my point is at a place where they can't push it around. So that's what those three, four capriccione mean. Let's bring up my slides again. present. Cool. Don't parry if you can help it. So if our opponent's very strong and they're just throwing shots, like, if they're so much stronger than us, they might be able to blow through our parries and stuff. So we want to try to use distance and measure and voids to defeat them instead. Things like retreating, if they lunge and they just barely don't hit us, perfect. The blade can be like a couple of inches away from us, but if that's the extension of their lunge or their passing lunge, they're fully extended and we're at a point where that we can strike around them much easier. Use sidesteps and evasion, so like step offline. I know Italian rapier can be very linear and they'll touch the way that we see it in the SE and HEMA. It's very much closer to like epi or foil fencing where people just go back and forth in a straight line. But take those offline steps. You don't need to be full of stress or like walk in a circle, but just taking small angles on a circle or on angular steps and stuff can take you away from where their sword is and be able to strike them easier. And use gerardas. These are the fancy voids that you see people with a, like, it looks like they're turning their back to their opponent and stuff. It's super fancy and pretty looking. This is a good ways of striking around your opponent's sword while they're trying to use their strength. We can also use invitations, and there's two types of invitations we can do. We can use invite them to with the sword, or we can invite them with our body. So the first is we can invite them with our sword by just kind of leaning forward or extending our sword forward. So as our opponent moves to final blade, we can do a capriccione and strike them in that tempo. So it's kind of like striking in the primo tempo as well. We can also provoke them to attack our body by giving them a tempo or opening the line that looks so juicy that they just can't help it, that they go to strike us. And as they try to do that, we can break measure by stepping back. So we can do this, if you go into that more Fabris forward posture, it really makes the head the main target. So we can kind of like maybe drift our guard just enough that they really want to hit our head. So as they lunge, we can pull our head back, and now we can like use the offhand or do step around their blade to strike them. Or even if we're from the leaning back stance, like we think of when we see Capifaro or Gigante and stuff, we can sort of bite them, hit our body, take a retreat as they lunge at us, and then strike around them and stuff. And I guess the next point, strike around the sword, not through the sword. If they're stronger than you, then you're just not going to be able to strike through the blade. It's going to be very tiring on your arm, which is going to put you at a disadvantage. And also, this doesn't matter as much to the SCA unless you're part of the wrestling or grappling experiment, but don't get too close to a stronger fencer, because they might just decide, screw this sword business, let's just wrestle. So again, in the SCA, on our basic rapier rule sets, that's not really a problem. But from a martial A&S stance, if we're actually dueling to the death and you're much stronger than me, I'm not going to want to get too close where you can just use your strength to overpower me. Moving on to the weaker fences, the advantage of being weaker than your opponent, none, unfortunately. You do have some disadvantages. It's harder for you to control your opponent's sword. It's harder for you to strike through your opponent's sword. But you must strike with your sword. This is assuming that you're fighting with just single rapier and not have an offensive secondary weapon like a dagger. Because you're not going to win a wrestling match against someone that's stronger than you. So if you're stronger than your opponent, how can you defeat them? Subjugate the opponent's sword is what they say. So that just means dominate your sword, control their sword. Use your strength to be able to find and gain your sword so their sword is pushed out of the way so when you strike, they're not able to parry or strike you. Press against their sword so they can only be free by a cavicione. This is specifically from Alfieri, who talked about actually putting blade pressure against your opponent. Fabris is very much of the idea of not to put any blade pressure on your opponent's sword until you actually are striking them. So this is just two different, they have slightly different viewpoints on that. You want to strike in the tempo of the weak fencer's cavicione. So if you're stronger than your opponent, you have them found. As they start to do the disengage, that's when you want to strike and hit them. If they don't do a cavicione, so they don't disengage while you have control over the sword, even easier for you, you can just get into the measure you need to and then strike them while they're just kind of standing there looking at you cross-eyed. If they try to run away, follow them. But again, you want to make sure you always have control over their sword. They're going to be trying to disengage back and forth, so you need to make sure you have very good guards and are able to continue to control this sword with your own Kenbushonins or with both the star blades, but it's just, which is turning your hand from one guard to the other is like a really watered down definition of it. And again, if you're in a tournament that allows for grappling and stuff, depending on the rules, if you're stronger than your opponent, you might want to decide wrestling is your better option than trying to actually fencing and stuff. But definitely don't do that if they have a dagger, because getting close to anyone with a dagger is just bad news, regardless if they're shorter, taller, weaker, or stronger than you. All right, now we're going to go to what gets kind of super interesting, and this is the four Hippocratic humors. So the four Hippocratic humors basically takes these different ideas, and so Alfieri takes the four Hippocratic humors and categorizes fencers into four temperaments of combatants that one might run into. And these are really just like buckets. Obviously, people aren't as neat as we sometimes like to try to define them, but if this can kind of give people a starting point of analyzing different types of opponents and stuff like that. So kind of realize someone might be a mix of these four at any time, depends on the tournament, depends on who they're fighting and stuff. But at least this kind of gives you some general tactics for approaching where they might be at mentally at a given point. But the four we're going to look at is timid, reckless, phlegmatic, and choleric. So starting off with the timid opponent. So the characteristics of a timid opponent is they will approach with very short steps or have a narrow stance. They will always run away from engagement. So this person's going to do a lot of retreats, possibly even as when lay on is called. I think we've all run at least seen different at least one fencer who is starting out of measure from the opponent. As soon as lay on is called, they take a couple steps backwards, regardless if they're taller or shorter or stronger or weaker than an opponent. Lay on is called, they're just trying to get more distance from their opponent. And a timid fencer is more likely to parry everything thrown at them, because they're just so nervous and scared. Anytime the blade comes near them, they're just going to try to get their sword on there, or they're going to try to run away. So in the SCA HEMA setting, we might see this kind of come through with new fencers who are still in the early stages of their own development. So maybe this is one of their first tournaments, and they just have a lot of nerves, performance anxiety. Maybe they haven't learned a lot of fencing techniques, so they don't have a lot of confidence in their own skill. I think that's where we see it the most in our sport version of rapier fighting. But I think you also will see it in different types of tournaments too. Like someone might be more timid in a one and done tournament than a bear pit, right? So a bear pit, if you get hit and you're dead, you just go to the end of the line and you get to fight for however long the tournament's going on. In a one and done tourney, if you get hit and killed, well, you're done for that tournament. And if that's the only tournament for the day, unfortunately, that can be pretty disappointing and stuff. So people will approach different tournaments differently. So someone who might be more aggressive or more confident in their fencing might become more of a timid fighter, like in a one-and-done tournament. Or if they're fighting someone who they think is just much more, highly more skilled than they are, too, they might approach their opponent in a more timid fashion. So how do we defeat the timid fighter? Employ fence. So again, we're thinking about a timid fencer who's always trying to parry everything that's being thrown at them. That means that we can put them into what the Italians call obedience. So they're doing the motions that we want them to do, which means we can predict where they're going to be and where they're not going to be. So I can fade to at their inside line, so maybe closer to the chest of their offhand. They go to parry it, I can disengage to their right pack, if they're a right-hander, and strike them in that chest where their sword isn't able to defend them in that moment. Use a variety of attacks and footwork. Really try to confuse them and stuff. Press them with the strong blade and get them to make moves that you can predict. So this, again, goes going into putting them into obedience. It's much easier to defeat an opponent if you know what they're going to do. Intimidate opponents can be pretty predictable in terms of if they're going to do a lot of parries and stuff like that. So we want to basically heighten the timid fighter's fear a little bit, but we don't push them so much they become reckless. So at this point, this is kind of like the idea of the cornered animal, where like, we might even physically see this in fencing in the SCA, you know, where there's like an actual corner of the list that they get pressed into, where they realize their back's to the wall, they're kind of screwed, and they just kind of launch themselves recklessly without really thinking about protecting themselves to try to land the shot. So we want to like keep them scared, but not so scared that they just kind of like feel like they need to do something to save their life and hit us when we're not really expecting it. That's the one caveat about approaching the team offensive. Next up is on the other side of this quadrant is the reckless opponent. So the characteristics of a reckless fighter is they're very chaotic in their attacks. They're going to rush you without bothering to use good guards or measure. They're going to use like their genetic advantages more than techniques. So if they're taller or faster or stronger, they're going to try to use that to defeat you more than what we would describe as good Italian rapier technique. And they might be just overly optimistic of their own skill. I forget if it was Alfieri or Fabris, but they kind of call it cheerfully optimistic. They just think they're going to get you, and they're just going to come forward right away. So we kind of, in the SA HEMA side, we might see this in new and intermediate level fencers. Once they might not have a ton of confidence in their own skill, but have a lot of confidence in their own athletic abilities. So this might be a newer fencer who doesn't have a lot of experience using a fencing system, but they are very athletic. They're fast, they're strong, they're tall, they're agile. And they're going to try to beat you using one of these natural abilities of their own. So this is one of the fences that you really need to worry about once lay-on is called, because this is one of the fences that are more likely to just try to take your play in bull rush. So anyone that's just trying to run you down all the time might kind of fit more into this reckless opponent, because they're not really worried about good tempo or measure or their own safety. They're just worried about trying to get score points, get that touch on you, get as many points and stuff as they can. So how do you defeat someone that's just going to try to bull rush us? First off, we need to defend against that initial rush. If we know we're facing a reckless opponent and they're going to try to run us down as soon as lay-on is called, we need to defend against that first onslaught. If they're stronger than us, they might be trying to grapple us. Again, we don't need to worry about that unless we're in a tournament that allows for grappling. But it doesn't mean they still might be trying to get pass out point for other reasons. But because they're stepping forward so fast, it does give us good tempos that we can use to hit our opponent. So as they are coming forward really fast, as they step into our measure that we can hit them with, we can strike them. We can use retreats and then strike in tempo. So as they're coming forward, we can retreat, and then quickly do a lunge as they're coming forward while they're thinking we're still running away from them. So like the strength of the reckless fighter is that they're very confident that they're just going to come on forward. We can also use that as their weakness, because we know they're going to be coming forward. We can kind of trick them into coming forward and striking them when they're not expecting it. Again, my note here, in the SCA, grappling is less likely unless it's in a experimental grappling rule set. You might see it in some HEMA tournaments, maybe. But a reckless fight is more likely to charge forward to get past your points, to infight, perhaps. Or to maybe shank you with a dagger if you don't have one, or just be able to catch you unaware with a quick strike. All right, the phlegmatic opponent. Characteristics of the phlegmatic opponent, they are confident but not overconfident in their abilities or in the fight they're stepping to the list with. They're prudent in their attacks and in the defense. That means they have strong guards, they're not impatient, they're very cold and collected, methodical, calculating. They're very confident in their skill. They're very good in their skill, and they're more than willing to wait for their opponent to make a mistake to strike than to like possibly force a mistake and get hit themselves and stuff. So I kind of see in the SA and the HEMA, I kind of see the phlegmatic opponent as the paragon of the duelist. They're the top fencers, and not just in performance, but also in skill. So performance is really wins, losses, do you win a lot of fights? Do you win a lot of tournaments? But I also, in my skill, I mean, like, they have a lot of book knowledge and they're able to use that book knowledge in fights and stuff. So the, you can be a very highly skilled fighter and not get a lot of wins for other reasons, because we're playing a sport. There are rule sets we need to work by that can sometimes work to our disadvantage, but it doesn't mean that that fencer isn't highly skilled. So I just want to kind of really kind of draw the line before performance and skill. There's some overlap, but they're not necessarily the same thing. So this fencer really knows what they're doing. They're most likely going to go deep in the tournaments. If you're like at K&Q, you kind of look around your pool, you kind of point out the people that you really need to worry about, because they're just very confident, highly skilled, and are willing to wait it out for you to make a mistake to hit you and stuff like that. So how do we defeat someone who is seen almost as like this, put on a pedestal of performance and skill, just extremely good? We need to take the initiative. We can't just hang back and wait all day. We need to force the phlegmatic fighter to make a mistake. So we can use boldness to get them to kind of like fear, get some, a little bit of anxiety and maybe make a mistake. If we let them feel like they're in control of the fight and they can stay calm and collected, they're fighting their fight and they're going to beat you. But if we can make them feel a little bit nervous for whatever reason, kind of throw them off their game a little bit, we can maybe get them to make a mistake that we can take advantage of. But we need to make sure that we're doing that using still good fencing technique. I can be bold, but if I'm being bold and reckless, I'm going to eat. I'm going to take steel to the face, and my day, I'm going to have a very bad tournament day and stuff. So I want to make sure that I'm forcing them to fear this anxiety or be a little bit off their game while still using good technique myself. I can use invitations. The Alfieri calls it shimate. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. My Italian isn't that fantastic, but it's invitation. It's basically make them think they can strike us in one place, and then as they go to hit us there, we hit them well where they're not, while using, while closing off the line, or we can use voids and stuff like that to basically get around where they're trying to hit us and stuff. Once you have the advantage over your opponent who's considered a phlegmatic fighter, don't relinquish this. So if you're fighting someone who's very good and you have control over the sword, don't double guess yourself and then get rid of your advantage and then retreat out of measure. If you have control over the sword and you have the advantage, press your advantage, because you might not get another shot at them like that. And if you can't confuse them, try to strike them in tempo as they step into measure. So again, like, if they're very strong in their guard, you might want to hang out of their measure and try to wake them out to try to get them to approach you, and then strike them in that prima tempo as they're coming forward. Or at least if you're short of them, steal measure from them and then get in closer when you can hit them. Last up out of the four temperaments is the choleric fighter. This person is who we think are the hotheads are. I don't think we want a ton into these type of fighters in the SCA. But like once in a while, usually someone kind of like lose their cool. Maybe they might not be hot-headed in a like sportsmanship-like idea, but they might be very impatient while fighting. So I'm kind of like using those as two ways of thinking about this choleric fighter. So they might be impatient and swift to anger. They're very restless. They don't want to wait, hang back and wait for you to come to them. They're more likely to just want to approach you. They're very ferocious in their fighting. So you might feel like they're very overly aggressive. So you, like in a very extreme setting, you might actually, even in the SAA or HEMA, actually feel physically afraid of them for a second moment or two, which is its own problem. I don't think we run into that a ton, so I don't think it's a huge problem. But once in a while, I run into people who like fought someone, they were just literally afraid of them. So this is an opponent you don't want to be for a bunch of different reasons. One, it's just not a good mindset to win fights, but it's also not a good mindset to have in terms of building a good fencing community. And this fence is also going to throw a lot of shots. Again, they're impatient. They're just going to throw shots and shots and shots and hopefully want to hit you. So in the SC HEMA setting, I kind of see this as a fencer that might be highly skilled, like the phlegmatic opponent, But while the phlegmatic opponent has the virtual patience to wait for the right opportunities to hit their opponent, the choleric fencer has little patience and is just going to try to hit you one way or the other. So it's similar to the reckless fighter, but while the reckless is very incautious, they just don't realize that they're maybe not as good as they think they are, or that their strategy isn't as good as they think it is. The choleric fencer is just impatient. So it might play out with similar ideas of them just coming forward very aggressively, but their reasons for it and their mental reasons for it, psychology, for a better word, is a little bit different. So how do we defeat this opponent? One, don't rush to meet them. They're gonna come towards you. And if they're impatient, they're definitely gonna come towards you a lot. Because they're throwing a lot of shots, we can use parry or posts. Or if we control the blade, we can strike in a contra tempo. Contra tempo is striking in the tempo they're trying to strike us. So I have control over my opponent's blade. They disengage, so they do the cavicione to try to strike me. I can strike them in that tempo while closing off the line so they can't hit me. So I can do a lot. I got to be a little bit more defensive, but I can use their aggressiveness and their impatience to create opportunities to hit them. Use measure. Don't be afraid to retreat, especially if you're a taller fencer and your opponent's shorter than you and also impatient. You definitely want to make sure that you are using retreats and using distance to keep them away from you. Alfieri says to chastise them. So basically trash talk, to basically further infuriate them to make them even more impatient. I don't promote the use of trash talk in SEA or HEMA. It's just not good sportsmanship. And I'm a big proponent of good sportsmanship and rather to lose being a good sport than to win being a bad sport and cheating and all that kind of stuff. So I kind of put trash talking in that same bucket. It's not cheating, but it doesn't build a healthy community, and because we're not fighting each other to the death. This is just for fun. Community should really be one of the virtues that we should be upholding. But it's something Alfieri mentioned that you attacked to use. I wanted to put that out there for the A&S side of all this. But you might be able to find other ways of aggravating your opponent. So if you think about trash talking as a way of making them more impatient and aggravating them, we can do this in a way that's still sportsmanlike and still kind of gives us the advantage. And that could be things like if we know that they're trying to come forward all the time, we just keep retreating, or just like not allow them engagement of our blades and not get close enough to them to hit us. It's going to make them more impatient, and they're more likely to make a mistake. That's a way we can provoke an attack and then strike them as they're just not thinking straight and they come forward. All right. So now we're going to talk about putting this all together. Now that we've learned how to defeat these different types of opponents, how do you know which of these categories your opponent happens to fall in and stuff? So first off, start out of measure. For the love of whatever god or gods or no gods that you pray to, start out of measure. In the SEA especially, we like to start way too close to each other. And in pickups, that's fine when you're doing a lot of resets. But if this is a tournament, we want to make sure that our opponent cannot hit us as soon as lay-on is called. We want to make sure that one of us needs to do at least one step before we can really engage blades and stuff. And by starting out of measure, we can observe our opponent. If I'm already in measure and lay-on is called, I don't have any time to see how my opponent's going to react to me or be able to read their body language or anything like that. And this is assuming that I'm fighting someone who I don't know. I've never fought them before. Maybe we're in a tournament like the Onsiorin tournament at Penzic, where I might get matched up with someone who I never met before, or maybe you're a new fighter in the like cadet tourney or the new fence attorney at Penzic. You find someone you don't know, you want to be further back, so you can kind of take them in and be able to read them. So first off, you want to observe their build. Some things are super easy to kind of figure out. Are they taller than you? Can be pretty easy to figure out if they're much taller or shorter than you. If they seem roughly your same height, like this, the advantage or the disadvantage of the shorter or taller fencer doesn't really matter as much unless the blade lengths that you use is different. So you want to try to figure out what length blade they're using. either using a really short blade or really long blade. Are there a tall fence using a shorter blade? That means the measure is going to be not as far as you would expect if they were using like a 45 inch. Same thing if a shorter fence is using a 45 inch blade. I would think that's a little bit maybe too long for what we would consider a shorter fence to be, but you need to be able to recognize they got a long blade and they're going to be able to hit you from further away. So you want to observe also their body language. What do they do once Leon is called? Do they move forward with great determination? So basically, are they going to just try to run you down? They might be choleric or reckless. Again, this is the opponent that you really need to worry about from as soon as Leon is called. If you're too close and start an orient and measure as soon as Leon is called, they're going to try to control your blade and hit you right away or just dive bomb you. So starting out of measure kind of gives you the breathing room from the opponent that's most dangerous from the Leon call. If Leon is called and they just kind of stand there and just stare at you, well covered behind their guard, or if they're so far away they don't need to be on guard, they might be more of a phlegmatic opponent, so you might be dealing with someone who's highly skilled. And if they retreat right away, you might be fighting someone who's a little bit more timid. Obviously, your opponent might be trying to trick you by pretending to be one of these things that they're not. But if that takes so much forethought from your opponent, that if they're really thinking about trying to trick you on that level and think that you're going to be picking up on that, then they're either so skilled that they have brain power to spend on that, or they're not spending it on things they really need to be worried about, like what are you doing with your blade and what your measure is and stuff. So I tend to try to believe what I'm seeing from my opponent until that happens to change. And that's more likely to change once the blades are crossed and stuff. We can also see how the opponent is moving. Are they rocking with weighted shifting advancing steps, or is their gait very smooth? If they're really kind of rocky with their steps and just it's not a very smooth glide, almost dancing-like gait, they might be a little bit on the newer side. If they're taking very clumpy steps forward to you, again, so they might be more choleric or reckless. You can also see what their blade work is like. Are they moving their blade very fluidly and confidently, something that's almost like a dance-like with their hands, or they're really using their sword like with a club. If they're kind of like trying to really use their sword like a club against your blade, they might be one, if they hit your blade, you might be able to tell if they're stronger than you, and that's kind of super useful to know. But also, you can get an idea of what type of attacks they're going to do. Someone who's very club-like isn't going to have very dexterity of hand, most likely, so you might not have to worry about them really doing like feints or any like disengages that might be able to trick you in a very quick fashion. You might be a little bit clunkier if they try to do that. You can also use low investment risk attacks or probes to see how they react. So if we're out of measure, I can just kind of reach my hand out so our tips are just crossing each other and see what my opponent does. If they're twitchy and run away, they might be more timid. Do they hold their ground? Do they try to press against my blade? Are they stronger than me when they're trying to do that? Or do they seem annoyed as they try to reach my blade that I pull my blade back? These are all small bits of information I can gain from my opponent, and I can quickly kind of go run through my macros of these different categories of fences and figure out what my best techniques or strategies of approach to them might be. So what does this mean to us as modern practitioners? One, we should know what type of fighter we are. It's great to know what type of opponent we're fighting, but it's really important to know who you are as a fighter. What are your weaknesses? How can your opponent defeat you? It's really good to know if you're a short fencer, what someone taller than you might do to try to defeat you, so you can figure out how to get around that. Maybe you can use your weaknesses as an advantage. Maybe like if you're weaker than your opponent, you can hold out your blade to try to get them to take your sword strongly like they want to do and strike around their sword with voids or yields or do something else and stuff. But it's a way of using your weakness and turning it into a strength by kind of tricking your opponent to thinking that weakness is something that you can take advantage of. But you can only do that if you know what your weaknesses are. But it's also good to know what your strengths are too, so you can try to leverage that as much as possible as well. Learn how to quickly analyze your opponent. This is easier said than done and takes a lot of practice. So I think a way you could do that is at your weekly practices when we're all together trying to take. You can do this even from the sideline. Watch a couple of fences from your practice and try to analyze and try to figure out, are they a taller fencer than you, shorter? It's pretty easy to figure out. Figure out where their temperament is typically as a fencer. Maybe they fight you a little bit differently, but you can kind of get a general idea of how they approach a fight and kind of analyze what they like to do, where they're weak, what their weaknesses are and stuff. But you really need to kind of put time and effort into that and just try to do that at tournaments. Tournaments is the last place you want to try to be learning how to fight. So really try to use your practices to work on these nitty-gritty things that are kind of, I'm going to call them soft skills, because it's not something you can just do over and over and over, like disengages or lunges are, but they're super important to improving yourself as a fencer. And again, it's important to remember that these are all general ideas and neat little buckets to put people in, but we don't fit in neat little buckets. People kind of change depending on what side of the bed they woke up on and depending who they're approaching and stuff. It's more shades of gray and gradient than four distinct quadrants and stuff. And I am working on classes for these different ideas in which we can kind of actually work through these different tactics and techniques and stuff. So once we can all hang out together, I'll try to find time to actually teach those in person. And these are just the different sources for the images and the books. And we'll go into Q&A.